guys, welcome to my channel. My name is Reading Bear and I hope you are ready for some more stories. And today, we will take a look at some new Pori Ranch content.
If you enjoyed my content, please don't forget to subscribe to my channel and post some bear emojis in the comment. And now, let's dive right into the stories.
First one is titled, Don't Mess with the Long Memory of the Law, a Cautionary Tale. With the permission of my friend whose tale this is, comes this tale of petty revenge served cold. This story begins 32 years ago. My friend, Rick, was a young police constable on traffic duty. In my town we have a road that, in those days, had a blind curve due to heavy shrubbery and tree growth. It was also a connecting road to a secondary highway, so people tended to come into town hot and hit that curve too fast. Pedestrians, bikers, and other cars were often hit from behind. And finally, when a young girl was hit on her bike, the police and city decided to crack down. Rick parked his police car at the entrance to an empty lot, situated just before the curve. Incoming cars would see him and slow down. One night, the owner of the empty lot, Jimmy, appeared and asked him what he was doing. Rick said his presence was part of a traffic calming initiative. Jimmy told him to get off his property, and he didn't care about the initiative. He called the local detachment and told the commander to keep the police cars off his property. Many years later he sold the property undeveloped, but that is another story. Rick complied, and, sure enough, a few weeks later there was a near-fatal accident involving a speeding car and a motorcycle. The city eventually reconfigured the entire curve with traffic lights and a new intersection. Fast forward 30 years. Rick had risen through the ranks and was a very senior officer in the police HQ. His office was on the fourth floor and only those with special access got up there. The HQ was undergoing some retrofitting that included electrical work. The main power/utility room was on the fifth floor and there were two ways to access it, the short way, cutting through the fourth floor offices to a special staircase, or the long way, a 10-minute walk around to the back of the building and a 5-story walk up the stairs. Guess who was a contractor on the job? Yes, Jimmy. He sweet-talked a security officer into giving him a special pass for the fourth floor so he could take the shortcut to the power room. Normally, contractors do not get passes unless they are working on the fourth floor directly. Rick came out of his office one day and spotted Jimmy entering through the security door. He recognized him immediately. "Hey, what are you doing here?" Rick asked. "Oh, I have a pass. I'm working in the power room on 5," Jimmy said. "A pass? Let me see that," Rick said. Jimmy handed it over. Rick looked at it, then put it in his pocket. "Contractors walk around," he said, and directed him back out. He called security and made sure they understood he was not to enter the building but walk around the back and up the access stairs. The job took several months into the winter. The walk was cold. Like the revenge. Next one is titled, Revenge Backfires. This is not my story, but my father's. He's 86, so this incident occurred 75 to 80 years ago. My father and his cousin used to go to the same school. There was another boy in the school who was a rival. One day this boy, let's call him Ben, bet my father that he couldn't jump off from the clock tower. The winner would get a pound of a particular type of dessert. Anyhow, Dad climbs the clock tower and jumps down from the first floor. Luckily he only happened to fracture his legs near the ankles. Ben got so scared he put my dad on his bicycle and dumped him in front of my grandfather's house and sped away. 6 months later when Dad recovered and rejoined the school, it was time to collect. Ben refused to make good on his side of the bargain. One day Dad and my uncle decided that if the two of them ganged up, they could beat him up. So a plan was concocted. Time and place carefully chosen so nobody would see them in the act. Everything went smoothly. They beat up Ben and had him pinned down under them. And then they realized the big flaw in the plan. How to get up. So the two of them began crying. Now there were three boys who were crying, the bully who was still pinned under these two little boys and these two. Luckily after a few minutes, the Ben's elder brother happened to pass by and saw them. This apparently is how the conversation went. Ben's brother, what's happening here? Ben, these two beat me up. Ben's brother to my dad and uncle, so, why are you crying? Dad and uncle, if we get up, and let him go he will beat us up again. Epilogue, Ben's brother was so amused by this story he told Dad's elder brother the entire thing. This led to a good thrashing for Dad at the hands of my grandmother, who couldn't figure how Dad had managed to break his ankles. Ben was punished at his home for his share in the antics and making stupid bets. Dad did manage to eat his pound of dessert though. Grandma made him eat that and nothing but that for a whole month. He developed an aversion to it and doesn't have it till date. Next one is titled, Just Take Your Stuff Go. Okay. I caught my ex-wife cheating a few years ago and during the ensuing argument she said just get your stuff and go, if you're going. Okay, no problem. Next day she goes to work, I take the new TV, fridge, freezer, all my clothes and electronics in the front door, which I just replaced and it was still outstanding on my credit card. I leave about 5 minutes before she's due home and the neighbor's keeping an eye on the place until she gets there. As you can imagine, I got a really interesting phone call which I sent to voicemail. About an hour later I get a call from the police. She'd said that I stole the front door. I offered to show the police that it's on my credit card and hasn't been paid for yet, so it's mine. Never went back or spoke to her again. Always wondered how she managed with no front door until she got it replaced. Edit, one of her favorite expressions whenever we had a disagreement was "you know where the door is." This time I definitely did, it was in the back of my van. Next one is titled, Air Force Captain Attempts to Public Humiliate Me. Some background info. When I was little, about a year old, I just started walking and had an accident where my mom accidentally spilt boiling water on me. She was cleaning the baby bottles and ended burning my arm and part of my neck. My mother to this day will cry every time bringing up the story. For me, I was too young to remember, so it really doesn't bother me. 100% an accident, just should have been more aware of her surroundings and has been a very loving mother throughout my life. I was new to the Navy, just reaching my first duty station. Even though I was newly enlisted, I still had an extensive knowledge about the lifestyle as my dad served 21 years. In a group of about 30 to 35 joint service personnel, this Air Force captain comes up to me and starts yelling at me in front of everyone, saying how I was out of regulations for having hickeys on my neck. Trying to make an example out of me how this is unacceptable. In the military we have a phrase. Praise in public, discipline in private. I simply replied with a stern voice. Ma'am, for a captain in the United States Air Force, I thought you would have a little more respect for someone who's been physically abused as a child. And I just went back to my computer and started working. As you can imagine, she was left there speechless as the whole office stared at her in disgust, as many of them knew that my scars were burns and not hickeys. I hope she learned her lesson and follows the praise in public, discipline in private motto. Next one is titled, Driver Gets Mad About Traffic and Gives Me the Finger. I was driving home from work on the freeway one late afternoon. Like a typical day in Los Angeles, there was a lot of traffic. I'm driving along and there's this minivan behind me that starts tailgating me. It's not like I can go any faster, so I ignore it. Then the car proceeds to start honking. Still nothing I can really do. The driver then cuts to the lane next to me, rolls down her window, starts yelling and gives me the middle finger. I usually ignore stuff like this, but I was pretty annoyed at this point, so I rolled down my window. I point at her tire while she's yelling at me and yell, "You have a flat." She's still yelling at this point, so I say it again. She's shocked and proceeds to pull off to the side. I watch her in my rearview mirror from a distance as she gets out to inspect her perfectly fine tire. Next one is titled, Typical Karen Story. During the super freeze of Houston, I, along with most Houstonians at the time, were out driving around looking for an open gas station for our generators and vehicles. People were just sleeping in their vehicle at the time, with most of Southeast Texas out of power. As I pulled into the HEB gas station on I-10 and Pinoak, the Whataburger opened. I left for maybe 15 minutes to bring the gas home, and in that time a line from hell emerged. I mean literally 300 yards-ish of cars. There is a front entrance, but it was clearly blocked by this long line of very hungry people. Now I've been waiting probably a good hour. It was chill, as everybody would rather be there than their homes at the moment. So I pull up to that front entrance, about to be in the parking lot and oh so close to ordering, when Karen with her F-350 pulls in and acts as if she's gonna cut off the 50 or so people stretched to the side highway. I roll my window down, clearly pointing out everyone behind me. She waves her hand like, "Sorry, I don't have a choice." So being the happy-natured man I am, I decided to pull off the line a little and basically bring our vehicles toe-to-toe. I dramatically put my car in park, motion to the people behind me to basically touch my bumper, and waited. Now she can only go backwards back onto the highway or by us and take the drive of shame past this whole line of cars, which never wilted in strength since I got into line. This goes on for maybe 3 minutes, but now the whole line of people are laying on their horns too. You could feel social pressure from all these people that this is more important than food, and no one had a problem waiting till she left. Then right on time another truck pulls in behind her, lays on his horn, and she finally flips me off, does a U-turn and goes on her way. Satisfying as hell. Next one is titled, A Customer Was Mad I Gave Them Extra Time So I Gave Them Less. I'm 31 male, a trucker for a parcel shipping company, and my main job is to pick up parcels from big customers and haul it back to the terminal for distribution. I've been doing this for about 7 years now and I'm very good at my job. I have a set route every day and the same customers. They have a deadline for pickup, which is stated in a contract. But traffic is unreliable and sometimes stuff just happens. I sometimes have extra pickups or in rare cases deliveries that make me a little late. Usually no problem, I know my route and can drive in the lost time. Or I have their number and can call to tell them I will be late. I have a customer who is set to be picked up from let's say 17:00 every day. Because I'm a very efficient driver, I rarely need to be there before 17:30 to be in time for my next customer. Which gives them extra time to pack orders as they are still open until about 19 in the evening. There are no other trucks incoming at the time, so I'm not blocking anything. Extra time should be good, right? Except they have this annoying habit of never being finished on time, and even when they see me loading up the truck they just dally around not finishing. Usually they come running when I'm closing the truck to tell me they got more and I need to wait. Before they run around trying to pack and secure the last pallet. And sometimes when I get there they are not. There will be a finished pallet ready for me but no people. No problem though, I just load up and leave. Usually about 10 to 15 minutes later they then call me to say I forgot a pallet and need to turn around. That they can't be expected to be done cause they never know when I arrive. I always arrive within a 15 minute window. Every day. If I'm later I call them. They have extra time and they still can't be finished on time. And try to blame at me. Not the first time this has happened. I got so tired of it I went back to arriving exactly at my scheduled time. And leaving on time. They weren't finished? Too bad, I have the contract on my side. They agreed to it and signed it. They then tried to call my boss and complain because now I left almost 30 minutes earlier than before. But he's awesome and just said tough luck, not my problem. Last one is titled, Caused My Food Stealing Roommate to Make His Mom Cry. So this happened way back in 2013. I was living in a large space with 5 roommates. One of my roommates was known for borrowing food including expensive stuff like meat but never replacing it. Well, one day I knew his mother was coming to visit and stay a few days and his mom absolutely loved horses, so what I decided to do was bait this roommate with horse meat. It's not common in the US but legal to buy imported, so I acquired some nice thin cuts and I sliced most of it and salted and left in a Tupperware in the fridge while I went at the rest of the package with the horse meat store label in the freezer. Well, sure enough in the evening I noticed some of the horses gone, so I make a big deal about someone stealing some of my horse meat in front of his mom. They go haha. Very funny. Sure it's horse meat. And my roommate owns up to borrowing some meat he used to make him and his mom steak and eggs for breakfast and lies that he'll replace it. That's when I pull out the package from the freezer and prove it was in fact horse meat and his mom burst into tears crying to her son, how could you feed me horse? He definitely at least stopped borrowing my meat after that. Thanks for listening.